Welcome to this Environmental Justice Global Conference. We're delighted to have you all here for this amazing conference and for this particular panel on the rights and responsibilities in relation to the natural world. We have an incredible lineup of speakers and responders. But first, we want to give thanks to Amity Doolittle and Gerald Torres, our colleagues here at the Yale School of the Environment, for their remarkable work on this Environmental Justice Global Conference. And we also want to thank Kristen and Grace for their incredible work on all the tech and backup and support that we know takes a great deal of time and effort.
Tireless, yeah.
The suggestions here are when you have questions, you can put them into the Q&A box and leave the chat open. The format will be, we'll have the first two presentations of David and Catherine, and then we will have a few questions between them if they like. Then we will have the responders, and then a few more questions between them and the presenters, and then it will be open to Q&A. So we're looking forward to this remarkable conference and remarkable panel on one of the most important topics, both rights and responsibilities in regard to nature. Let me begin with a very brief introduction of David Cordero-Heredia. Now, this is all on the website. So I will simply say that David is the Associate Professor of Law and Director of the Human Rights Center at the Pontifical Catholic University of Ecuador. So he's coming to us today from Quito. He is also, he co-taught the International Human Rights Clinic Policy Advocacy at Cornell Law School for 1 year in 2018 and 2019. And he has an upcoming book that analyzes the addition of indigenous peoples' bills of rights in the Ecuadorian constitutions of 98 and 2008. So we're looking forward to that book, and we're especially looking forward to his talk this afternoon. David, take it away, please. Maybe I should just also introduce, okay.
Good afternoon. It is an honor to be here and especially to share this panel with Professor Iorns. My presentation is called How the Rights of Nature are Reframing Human Rights Strategic Litigation. In a brief intervention, I will address three topics. First, how human rights defenders and environmentalists are moving from the human rights defense to the rights of nature advocacy. Second, I will state some relevant differences between the rights of nature and environmental law. And finally, third, I will present three cases with pending decisions in Ecuadorian courts that illustrate this process. My argument is that recognizing and enforcing nature's rights offers a comprehensive new strategy to protect both nature and human rights. I'm addressing you from Quito, the capital of Ecuador. Ecuador is a small country the size of Nevada. Despite this fact, Ecuador is a mega diverse country, biologically and culturally speaking. We have several ecosystems that are the habitat of thousands of species, some of them endangered. Ecuador is also the home of 26 cultural groups with 14 different languages, ways of life, cosmovision, values, customs, spiritual practices, and ways to interact with nature. The country's economy depends on the exports of crude oil, and in recent years, governments are trying to add big mining projects as an alternative source of revenue. Some people could believe that coincidentally, natural resources lie in indigenous or peasants' territories in Ecuador. However, environmental justice literature shows us that there is no such thing as coincidence when companies and state allocate who must bear the burden of environmental impacts. Since 2004, as a law school clinical student, I have been working with impact communities in the justiciability of their infringed human rights in the context of the oil and mining business. Human rights are deeply related to the protection of nature for these peoples, mostly when we talk about indigenous peoples. And even among the indigenous peoples, this relation is even profound when we talk about indigenous peoples living in voluntary isolation, like the Taga Eri and Taromenane. In 2004, we presented a case for the violation of the right to a healthy environment because the government approved an oil project in a national park, the Yasuni Park, the home of the Taga Eri and Taromenane. The courts rejected the case based on two arguments. First, that we haven't proved how the intervention in the park will provoke damage to us, the plaintiffs. And second, that the law allows government to conduct extractive projects in protected areas. These experiences show us the limits of environmental law. We cannot deny that recognizing human rights to a health or the human rights to a healthy environment was an enormous advance. For some countries, it was the starting point for their own development of environmental law. But this right is ethnocentric. Nature could be protected only if it is connected with the rights of a person or a group. Nature does not have a value for itself. It is valuable only in relation to a human being. We found in this idea an epistemic problem. Human rights are built based on the modern person paradigm in a liberal and capitalistic society. The modern person is not connected with their land, which in cities, countries, jobs, all the time. Nature is not more than a group of goods that could be owned and could provide us some kind of benefit. Goods can be sold, can be exchanged, can be expropriated. When mining or oil companies are found accountable for polluting the environment, monetary compensation, exchange of lands, and other redress forms are offered. If the people involved declare that there is no price for their land or no other part of the planet where, or there is no other plan or other part of the planet where they want to live because they have a bond with nature, they are treated like radicals and the law does not support their claims. However, when we talk about nature's rights, we accept that all the species and all ecosystems have a value for themselves. It is a paradigm shift because we stop treating nature as bare property. On the contrary, we start considering nature as something of such inherent value that could not be monetarized. When rights of nature were recognized in the Ecuadorian Constitution of 2008, we have an opportunity to extend the community's ideas of nature's value and importance to all the relations that the Western society has with nature. In 2008, Ecuador took a big step in the direction of the biocentric paradigm, recognizing the rights of nature in the Constitution. Since then, at least formally, nature is a legal person whose rights violations could be presented to a court by any person and that have constitutional rights. The right to integral respect of its existence and for the maintenance or regeneration of its life cycles, structure, functions, and evolutionary processes. The rights to be restored, the state's duty to apply preventive and restrictive measures on activities that might lead to the extinction of a species, the destruction of ecosystems, and the permanent alteration of the natural cycles. As nature has recognized value itself, the government has to pound the impact on the environment in any hazard decision, no matter if there are or aren't people involved. The impact acts assess should respond to the question, is there any chance to provoke damage to nature that affects their self-regenerate chances? If there is, then government cannot move forward with its project. While impacts on people can be monetarized and compensations can be negotiated, usually in an unequal conversation, permanent effects on nature are forbidden. Environmental law appear as a response to the increasing environmental degradation. Before environmental law, no limit to human activities impacting the environment was settled. However, in the best scenario, environmental law has in the best scenario, climate change and species extinction were slowing down by environmental law. The lack of effectiveness of environmental law to stop our planet's rapid destruction is that the limits established by environmental law are created by a compromise between political, social, and principally economic interests. Environmental law tries to balance the profit with a certain amount of environmental protection. Politicians and business persons claim that too much protection to the environment means losing investment, because foreign investors will always look for the bigger profit that unregulated countries could offer. When human beings are involved, a significant profit always defeats the affected community's desire to stay in their lands. But nature has its own laws. Those laws are the ones that set the points of no return regarding the capacity of the planet to process the contamination and impacts of human activities. Human beings cannot negotiate those laws. The line traced by environmental law is so distant from the line traced by the laws of nature that the environmental degradation global phenomena are putting at risk all life forms on Earth. While environmental law is a human invention, laws of nature are not made, and we can understand the laws of nature through science. The rights of nature are radical proposals to push human laws closer to laws of nature. Nature is not voiceless, it talks with us through science and the wisdom of indigenous peoples. Throughout the rights of nature strategic litigation, activists, scholars, indigenous and peasant communities are trying to re-establish human activities limits. I will present three examples of those efforts. First, let's talk about, again, the Yasuni Park. The Yasuni Park is the core of the Yasuni Biosphere Reserve, including in the UNESCO Biosphere Reserve Program in 1989. It's a hotspot of biodiversity that attracts scholars from all over the world. It is a living biological laboratory. You can see these in the numbers on the screen. According to the Ecuadorian government's publications, Yasuni's biodiversity is unique. No other ecosystem on Earth has a higher number of species. The Yasuni is the territory of the Tagaeri and Taromenane people. As I mentioned before, Tagaeri and Taromenane are indigenous peoples living in voluntary isolation. Yasuni's subsoil is also a significant reserve of crude oil. In 2007, the government announced the Yasuni ITT initiative, a project that sought funding from the international community to keep the oil under the ground. The premise was, if the international community pays half of the revenues expected from the selling of the oil in reserve, then Ecuador will put the other half and Yasuni's oil reserve won't be touched. The initiative was well received by several countries and international cooperation agencies, but those do not fulfill Ecuadorian government demands. In 2013, the government canceled the project and announced that oil drilling in the park will soon start. For former President Correa, there was no recent evidence that the Tagarian terminal lived in the oil drilling area, and that the affectation to the park's area will be or less than 0.1%, something like 1,000 hectares. The revenues for the state were projected at $8,000 million. The operation was approved by the National Assembly or legislative branch, despite biologists' arguments about how animals, plants interact won't be, or impacts won't be only in the drilling area. Still, the noise and human presence will force animals to move and compete for territory and resources with other animals, altering the biological balance of the Yasuni ecosystem. Also, anthropologists showed their research about the patterns of seasonal migration of the Tagarian Terminani, what means that their presence cannot be established as if they were stationary. No reason was heard by the National Assembly, and the oil extraction moved forward. From the human rights perspective, indigenous peoples living in voluntary isolation, the Tagarian Terminani, are in permanent danger. They have suffered three registered massacres, the last one just a few months before the government canceled the Yasuni ITT initiative. 30 people, among men, women, and small children, were slaughtered. There are less than 300 Tagarian Terminani alive. All the efforts of indigenous organizations, human rights NGOs, and activists have shown ineffective. For the Tagarian Terminani, their territory is their life. They don't know other forms of living than hunting and gathering food freely in their forest. They don't want money. There is no money in their world. Another piece of land won't be the same for them. From the rights of nature perspective, the government allowed only 300 hectares of deforestation. Only one road was planned and approved. Satellite images prove that the authorized limit of 300 hectares of deforestation was greatly surpassed. And that other road of 2.2 kilometers was built. The extremely restrictive conditions of operations in the Yasuni Park are a consequence of the state's duty to prevent and restrict measures or activities that might lead to the extinction of species, the destruction of ecosystems, and the permanent alteration of natural cycles. A lawsuit will be filed based due to the breach of Article 73 of the Constitution. We will show how the government has trespassed its self-imposed limits and how this could impact the Yasuni. As I tell you before, science will play a fundamental role. Scientists will show how these activities impact affects the fragile balance of its megadiverse ecosystem. How any dangerous activity, as oil drilling, or invasive, as roads, shouldn't be allowed in the Yasuni ecosystem. If the Constitutional Court of Ecuador agrees, they will be doing more than protecting the Yasuni and the Tagaeri and Terminani. The court will be embracing the vision that the Tagaeri and Terminani have of the Yasuni. Yasuni as a living being, source of life, irreplaceable, indispensable, and worthy of an inherent value. The second case is the Coca River case. The Coca River is the source of clean water for several peasants and indigenous communities and two major national parks, the Sumaco Napo Galeras National Park and the Cayambe Coca National Park, These are two mega diverse ecosystems with endangered species like the spectacle bird or Andean bird, the jaguar, and the Andean condor. According to the IUCN, these species are endangered. You can see the numbers of the species in this slide of the presentation. In 2010, President Correa's government started constructing a hydroelectric plant in the Coca River called the Coca-Codo-Sinclair Project. The plant is the bigger of its class in the country and is producing 35% of its electric energy. It cost $2,000 million. Hydraulic engineers warned about the soil and at the margins of the river. They said that the dam will provoke a headward erosion, putting in danger the people living in the river's margins and the surrounding infrastructure, roads, oil pipes, and water plants. The projection was proved accurate. As you can see in the picture, the headward erosion was visible in river's margins. And even the tallest waterfall in the country, the San Rafael waterfall, suddenly disappeared in February 2020. Experts announced that this means that the river is changing their patterns, or in other words, the river was searching for a new path to flow. The headwater erosion is making the stream channel to lengthen. Parts of the roads have fallen into the river. And in March of 2020, the two more important oil pipelines of the country collapsed. 15,800 barrels of crude oil were spilled in the Coca River, affecting 97,000 people living in its margins. From the human rights perspective, a lawsuit was filed to protect the Quechua indigenous community's rights, 105 affected communities. The river, for them, was a source of clean water and food. The company owner of one of the pipelines and the government of Ecuador told the judge that they had been taking care of the impact community's necessities, providing them food and water. The judge decided against the Quechua communities in September of 2020 for the lack of constitutional basis of its claims, or their claims, which means no human rights violations were involved. For the judge, food and water can come from the river or the company's canned food and bottled water. From the rights of nature perspective, the river is a living being. The life it supports, their cycles, and its stream must have been considered when the Coca-Cola Sinclair was designed. The government analyzes proposals for building more dams or putting concrete in the river's margins to save its millionary project. However, what is suitable for the plant is not going to be necessarily good for the river. We are looking to open a national discussion among experts to find solutions that prevent permanent damage to the river's life cycles, structure, and functions. The rights of the river should prevail over the state's attempts to maintain the hydroelectric plant working. If possible, to save both will be perfect, but nature must have the priority. Finally, Los Cedros forest case. Los Cedros is a private conservancy project in the region of Intac, 3 hours away from the capital. It is a cloud forest in the Andean region, considered as a biodiversity hotspot. As you can see in the slide, this ecosystem has a large number of species. The monkey in this picture is a brown-headed spider monkey that is critically endangered according to the IUCN. Also, the IUCN has found 26 endangered species in this forest. In 2017, the Secretary of Mining approved two mining concessions for the National Mining Company that overlap Los Cedros Forest. Those were not the first attempts of the government to extract minerals in the Intac region. Intac communities experienced one of the worst environmental conflicts with a mining company in Ecuador. At the beginning of the new century, the Ascendant Cooper Company engaged in some of the industry's most reprehensible practices: community division, land trafficking, social organizing criminalization, and hired guns used to intimidate people. The attacks on the community were recorded in video and became viral. Several human rights organizations denounced the crimes of the company. Even an arbitration tribunal of the UN Citral gathered information about these atrocities and included them in its award. By 2008, the Ecuadorian government revoked Ascendant Cooper's mining concessions based on the attacks on the communities. The communities opposed to mining projects due to the severe impacts that mining projects will bring to the environment. The protection of the environment through private forests has been part of their plans to balance agricultural and tourism activities with the conservation of the environment. They demanded the respect for their development plans and prior consultation rights. The new concession over Los Cedros Forest initiated a new legal battle against the government. In 2019, the Provincial Court of Imbabura ruled in favor of the communities. The court suspended companies' activities based on the lack of proper consultation to the communities that live around the forest. However, in opinion of the court, there was no violation to the rights of nature in the case. The Constitutional Court selected the case to create a precedent on the rights of nature. From the human rights perspective, the communities that live in the surroundings of Los Cedros won an injunction order against the mining activities. However, the reason for the decision was the lack of consultation. Therefore, if the government and the companies promote a participation process, the ban could be lifted. Consultation results are not binding for the government. The government always retained the rights to extract resources of the subsoil. From the rights of nature perspective, there is enough scientific evidence of the vulnerability of the ecosystem of Los Cedros, including endangered species that will be affected by an open pit industrial mine. Experts from the most prestigious universities in Ecuador and scientists worldwide have created a robust scholarship on the importance of Los Cedros as a unique habitat. The resources mining will provide to the state does not justify the violation of nature's rights to the integral respect of its existence and the infringement of the duty to prevent and restrict activities that might lead to the extinction of species, the destruction of ecosystems, and the permanent alteration of natural cycles. Los Cedros Forest case hearing was a perfect example of nature's rights pushing environmental regulation closer to nature's rights, to nature's laws. It happened on October 19th. Over 60 interventions of amicus curiae participated. We can divide those interventions in two broad groups: the mining companies, lawyers, and the scientists. While the scientists, one by one, presented overwhelming data of the importance of the forest and the risk that will linger on its species if a mining project moves forward, the mining company's lawyers talk about revenues and the right of the state to extract minerals, even from protected forests. Cormac Cullinan, in his book Wild Law, said that nature is not mute. Nature talks to us through science. And that day, I completely agreed with him. The real voice from Los Cedros came from those scientists. While mining companies' lawyers were trying to keep the law in the ethnocentric paradigm, treating Los Cedros as property, the scientists were trying to persuade the court to limit human activities to the point where species, including ours, could survive. In these three cases, we can find that these communities' human rights could be protected through the rights of nature. But communities are doing more than use nature as their shield. They are teaching us how they value nature. They are teaching us that for most of them, nature was never a good or property. They are teaching us that maintaining a healthy and respectful relationship with nature is something possible. And increasingly, modern Western peoples are embracing these worldviews and pushing the law in that direction. Cormac Cullinan calls this phenomenon the Earth jurisprudence. It is happening all over the world. And with every single court or parliament's victory, we are getting closer to revert the tendency of a permanent damaging our planet. Thank you.
Thank you so much, David. That was wonderful. And I just wanted to pick up your last point on Wild Law, this amazing book of Cormac Cullinan, whose foreword is by Thomas Berry. And Cormac was deeply indebted to Thomas Berry, who was our teacher for many years, and we edited his work. But you, David, did the Spanish version, along with two colleagues, of Wild Law. So we thank you for that. And Thomas Berry, around 2000, actually began to write the Principles for Earth Jurisprudence, of which there are 12. We'll be happy to share an article about this. And in 2001, he convened a conference with Andrew Kimbrell, the Gaia Foundation, and others, including Cormac, at the Arley Center outside of Washington, D.C. And they developed many of these principles for Earth jurisprudence. Later, a Center for Earth Jurisprudence was set up in Barry University and St. Thomas University in Florida, and finally an Earth Law Center, very much inspired by this tremendous synergy of Cormac, Thomas Berry, Andrew Kimbrell, and others. And John was at that conference in 2001. Then this is a wonderful segue, because Thomas says, just very, very briefly, about the rights of nature, that it includes the right to be, the right to habitat, and the right for all beings to fulfill their role in the ever-renewing process of the Earth community. And he says, especially we need to draw on science and indigenous perspectives for this. And this is a great segue to Catherine Ion's talk, because she's speaking especially about responsibilities, not just rights, which is a wonderful counterpoint to rights of nature. And her talk, which we've had a chance to see, is tremendous. She's a professor of law at Victoria University of Wellington in New Zealand. And she has 25 years of experience on indigenous rights, environmental law, international law, and statutory interpretation. She's a member of the IUCN World Commission on Environmental Law and academic advisor to the New Zealand Council on Legal Education. Much more could be said, but we'd love to welcome Catherine for her talk. Thank you very much, Catherine. Over to you.
Kia ora koutou and greetings from New Zealand. I'm Catherine Iorns and I'm an environmental law professor here, and I'm absolutely delighted that technology has been able to bring us together in this way, even while we missed out on meeting at Yale. So I've been asked to discuss some examples in Aotearoa New Zealand of what people often call rights of nature. It's where our government has given legal personality to some aspects of nature and established environmental guardians for those new legal persons. And so I have not been asked not just to describe some examples, but then to put an environmental justice lens over them to see how we might regard them and in terms of environmental justice concepts and perhaps how we can use them to further environmental justice discussion. And particularly, I mean, not just domestic, but the theme of this conference, global environmental justice. So I've picked just one example in as an illustration in this short video. And one example, and that's where our government has given legal personality to a river. We've also done it for a national park, but rivers certainly seem to have hit a nerve worldwide, and we've got quite a few examples of countries in various different ways establishing legal personality and/or a guardianship arrangement for a river. So I thought this is certainly the most relevant, and not so many countries will have national parks that then governments decide that they want to take out of national park status and give it its own legal personhood and separate guardianship body. So I'm just going to go ahead and share my screen. And minimize me. I'll give you first what I suggest are three lessons, three key points. So you've kept these in mind. These are the kind of things I'm trying to illustrate with the example. And the first thing that's key to remember, and I'll show you how this happened, is that in New Zealand, all of our examples of legal personality for nature have resulted from a human rights process, not an environmental protection one. So they are examples of Indigenous justice rather than environmental justice. And as part of that, they implement Indigenous concepts of guardianship over nature. And it was deliberately designed to implement those Indigenous concepts of guardianship. And one other key aspect that I think, perhaps the most important aspect, is that what I think they're most useful for in terms of a wider justice discussion is changing the status and mindset. They have this idea, right, that the river or the legal person owns itself. We don't own it. This changes our mindset about property, right? Our whole philosophy about property. And that's one of the most enduring legal tools that we have, the concepts of property. So if we shift that debate, we shift a whole bunch of other aspects of our legal system and environmental laws. So just keep those three things in mind through the discussion of this example. So if let's go to the map of where, so this is the map of the North Island of Aotearoa, and you can see in the centre of the North Island is a volcanic plateau, and the river starts up there by the mountains and winds its way down to come out at the shore at the town called Whanganui. And it's the longest navigable river in New Zealand with a length of 290 kilometres. And it passes through the traditional territory of a number of tribes that we call iwi. And you'll see iwi is in I've got a number of my slides. In March 2017, the New Zealand Parliament made the Whanganui River a legal person and gave it its own name, Te Awa Tupua. So it's actually quite different from many of the rights of nature examples, but in terms of coming from our parliament and certainly the way it arose. So I'll go in a little bit of the history and then what it looks like. Well, it's actually, before that, we've got an idea of the type of terrain. Much of the land, certainly for either side of the river's upper part, is in the Whanganui National Park. Though the river itself is not part of that park now, but you can see the type of terrain there. Then it also flows through farmland, a lot of farmland, as you can see, and as the longest navigable river, it's great for kayaking and canoeing. And when I mention the terrain, you can see where you haven't got farmland, where it hasn't been cleared, it would be difficult to make your way through that territory without this river. So the river's become the road for that area. And Māori were using it for centuries as their road and the connection between the different tribes up and down the river, you know, for trade and all sorts of other, everything they needed. For, you know, finding and farming food, you know, fish within the river as well as then traveling up and down it. And that relationship with the river, the relationship gave rise to a view or that central Māori cosmology that the river is their living ancestor. Right, it's absolutely central to their sustenance and being as peoples. And they say that it's that from time immemorial. So they believe that they're inseparable from the river, and the health of the people is intrinsically connected to and inseparable from the health of the river. And that gave rise to the saying, ko o te awa, ko te awa, ko o. Literally, or the transliteration, it means I am the river and the river is me. But obviously it means more than just a transliteration. It's about that interconnectedness between the people and the river and their well-being. So with colonization, Whanganui iwi tribes lost the legal and actual control over the river, and the New Zealand government assumed ownership and undertook numerous riverbed works, gravel extraction, water diversions for a hydroelectric power scheme, and you know, the travel, I mean, and as well as the land on either side of the river. So then you lose a lot of riparian rights as well. And of course, the government undertook these activities, ignoring the objections and the opposition from the local tribes. Grievances over this river were the subject of objections and petitions and court cases from the early 1900s until 2010. And it's actually been said to have New Zealand's longest running court case in relation to the treatment of the river. Māori have always asserted they are the rightful guardians and the river of the river and its Māori or its spirit or its life force. And they argue that they have the right to control the management of the river in order to uphold that spirit of the river. And so, for example, the mixing of waters in the power station, you know, diverted a river and joined two of them to go through this power station, that violated the various spirits of the different rivers and undermined their status as guardians. So there's a long-running grievances between Māori and the Crown, and there was an agreement, particularly in 2012, but certainly a change in approach in 2010, an agreement reached in 2012, to uphold that Māori cosmology in a different legal status over the river. And so this negotiation over historical grievances and arguments for reparations, for Indigenous reparations, is what led to the adoption of the legal personality. We have an agreement then to recognise the river. And we see here, and I give it a name, Te Awa Tupua, which is like the ancestor river, the grandfather river, comprises it as an indivisible and living whole from the mountains to the sea. All right, and I think what's most important, though, is that last line, incorporating physical and metaphysical elements. This is a section from the legislation, we've got there the spirit, the metaphysical element of the river being incorporated in that legislation and being recognised. A key guiding principle of the negotiations, as well as the agreement itself and then the legislation, was the saying about, ko o te awa, ko te awa, ko o, that, and they've got a translation in there saying that the iwi and hapu, that's the tribes and subtribes of the Whanganui River, have that inalienable connection with and responsibility to Te Awa Tupu and its health and well-being. And just as an aside, yes, this is a normal English language statute, and we have pepper-potted throughout all of our statutes here in Aotearoa the occasional Māori word like that. We don't use always the translation of tribes and subtribes. There are some words that New Zealanders are taken to know about from their indigenous language. And so in 2012, the agreement was to recognise Te Awa Tupu as the legal entity with standing in its own right. And that it would be incapable of being owned, and that its innate values would be recognised and provided for. And in 2017, that's exactly what the statute did. They've got this recognition that Te Awa Tupu is the legal person with, and they've got the standard phrase, all the rights, powers, duties, and liabilities of a legal person. I note that no one of those four was meant to be more important than the others. A lot of people focus on the word rights. That hasn't been focused on so much here. We notice it's got an interesting range of different types of status. For some purpose, it's a body corporate, and for other purposes in the legislation, it's a public entity. But the legislation also, most importantly, vested title to the riverbed in the legal person, Te Awa Tupu. I must note, not the water itself, because that's the subject of a separate political disagreement about who owns water in New Zealand. And the government insists that nobody owns the water, and it's partly because then once they started talking about ownership, then they're afraid they would have to make Indigenous reparations agreements because of having that taken away from Māori. So that's still an ongoing dispute. So a lot of people are quite surprised to find it doesn't include the water when that's such an integral part of a river. But we're talking about the riverbed and then the right to manage the river's interest as a whole, which obviously does as the ecosystem within the river. So we're still managing the water, even if it's not part of the title. And there's a lot of, you see, 26 other statutes affected by this one, including, you know, local government. I mean, a lot of different interests that are relevant to the river are affected. So the key aspect, and this is more so than the rights, was setting up the responsibilities to restore the tribal control and influence and ability to manage the river, to be responsible for its spirit. So it recognised that Māori concept of guardianship, we call it kaitiakitanga, and appointed two guardians to the office of what they call te pou, tupua. The pou is like a pole. You'd think of a guardian pole. And so these two guardians, one comes from central government, and one is appointed by jointly from the tribes. And I just note, when I said central government, we have a unitary system of government. We don't have a federal system. So we don't have a separate federal government with states underneath. We just have one unitary government. And the guardian's job is to promote and protect the health and well-being of Te Awa Tupu, to act and speak on its behalf, and to act consistently with the intrinsic values of the river, which they're called tupua tikawa, which will be written down by the guardians. They have an advisory group to support the two legal guardians, and a much wider strategy group, which they've called Te Kaupuka, Ngā Te Awa Tupua. There's up to 17 stakeholder representatives to help advise the advisory group and the POU about what kinds of things we need to be doing, what are the management decisions that should be made in relation to this river. And so that's why you've got the stakeholder representatives there from all those different areas: local, central government, conservation, so the Department of Conservation. Remember, the national park borders a chunk of that river. We've got recreation interests in the river, tourism interests, the electricity generator, of course, and there's local farmers. So, there's, and of course, right up front there, the iwi, or the tribes. And there is a fund, the government established a $30 million fund to help restore and maintain the health and well-being of the river. So that's the summary of what it does. So if we talk about, if we stand back a bit and look at what kinds of things that's doing in relation to rights of nature, you see the biggest focus is on responsibilities of guardians, to what they should be doing. It's what the acts established and then how they should be functioning. So it's not a rights focus. There's very few rights in there, and it's certainly not what we would call a rights of nature. If there's any rights, it's of the tribes. And so in that respect, it's targeted at cultural redress more than environmental improvement, even though that's one of those goals. So the intrinsic worth of the river is recognised, just not defined further. And rights of nature as a concept was thought of, I'll be honest, as irrelevant, because that's not what was being sought. What was being sought was the means to uphold responsibility as a tribe to a tribal ancestor. And so that transfer of property underneath the river was transferred from the Crown to the legal person, and that to enable a co-governance arrangement, and to so then the co-governors could exercise their responsibilities. So if you want this key summary, it's a responsibility framework that was implemented, not a rights framework. And then the rights are Indigenous ones of reparation and culture, and that right to recognition of their cosmology, that idea of we see the river as an ancestor, and we want that recognized in law. So in that sense, it's not a right of nature, but at the same time, it's an excellent illustration of the same tools. So we can certainly understand why you want to label it that as a right of nature. So as we've seen from the Ecuador example here today, but also there are, if you're aware, there are lots of other examples of rights of nature, legal personality being awarded, to rivers particularly worldwide. We've seen them in India, Colombia, Ecuador, and now Bangladesh. Actually, sometimes it's not legal personality. Sometimes it's literally just a right to go to court to represent their interests. But you can see the legal bases of these differ in all of these countries. Some of them focus on the rights, but some of them focus on human rights, like a human right to a healthy environment, and others focus on rights of nature. But then you also get some that focus on responsibility, a human responsibility to or for nature, and including to establish guardianship arrangements. But what are the legal bases? Some of them also focus on constitutional duties, and that's India's, for example. The method of ensuring responsibility is upheld can vary, and some people establish personhood, right? Others say it's a right, you have to be an advocate, like to go to court and advocate for that responsibility, to be the responsible person. Others establish a legal guardianship framework or a body. It could be permanent, it could be ad hoc requests or an ad hoc body. That method of creating personhood or guardianship has varied. In New Zealand, we've done it solely through a statute. In other countries, they've done it through courts. Ecuador's got that mix. You've got the framework in the constitution, and then you leave it to courts to decide who can be that guardian and when you're going to invoke it. What else have we got there? Some of them impose explicit duties on current and future generations, I should say. But all of them, nearly all of them, adopt this new relationship with nature. They represent, I should say, a new relationship. In New Zealand in particular, we recognise that ancestral relationship with the river or the national park. There's an agreement to date to recognise it in relation to a mountain as well, which again was a mountain national park. But We've got all of these differences worldwide in the way we've approached it. And I note that this doesn't depend on whether you're a common law system or a civil law system. And for example, Ecuador and the USA, a common law and a civil law system, have got more in common than the USA and New Zealand. And part of it was that not just that there's nothing to do with that civil common law, it's that constitutional basis and then the type of system you've set up. If you set up a constitutional right and then leave it to individuals to go to court to exercise that right, that's completely different from New Zealand, where we don't have a written constitution to put that kind of right in, where we have a parliamentary sovereignty system where statutes are supreme, and we like setting up statutory bodies, in this case setting up a framework to uphold that Indigenous concept. So you can see very different approaches, and I haven't even gone through the other ones in the world, but there are very different approaches worldwide, and a lot of it depends on the basis within the country for those kinds of where those rights might best sit. And I noticed that all of that, sorry, if you go back, that new relationship with nature, this idea that nature could be a person or the subject of rights, right, that someone could go to court for, very different from that Greco-Christian view which underlies most of the Western legal systems, where we've got one, it's a view of dominance, a view of dominance and control over nature, more like a slavery relationship than a responsibility one. If we have this idea that plants and animals are created for our purpose, for our provision, right? And there are phrases in the Bible that are frequently used to justify that kind of view, which has helped the Greco, the Aristotle, and the Bible view. This idea that everything is for our purpose. I know those are not the only phrases, particularly in the Bible, but they're often used in order to justify this particular view that we might want to take and enshrine in our laws. For example, think of Blackstone, which his commentaries is the basis for our property and environmental laws. The idea that God gave to the creator the dominion over everything in the natural world, right? And it's that God-given dominion that is the basis for our ownership of property, no matter what, you know, fanciful notions other people might suggest. And so this idea that nature could either become a person or be the subject of rights completely changes your view about our relationship with the natural world, that it isn't perhaps our slave. And so I like this idea that systems change starts, well, it needs to start with the mental model that underpins your systems, your laws, your behavior. And so that, I think, is the most interesting, most exciting thing about this idea that we can adopt these different views. It's that we could have a different mental model. In America, you have indigenous cosmologies that adopt the same kind of model, right? The idea that we don't own nature, right? Here's one quote from the Ogallala Nakota Sioux. But there are lots of these implications for environmental justice. I can think of two types. The first one is that most people see rights of nature as bringing in this idea of intrinsic value, right? That we consider nature for its own sake. Plants, animals, ecosystems have rights, and we can't do what we want with them. We can't treat them like slaves anymore. And that's whether you see them as having collective or individual rights. But the New Zealand examples bolster even a different idea of environmental justice, and that's the one that focuses on Indigenous conceptions of justice. So if you think of your environmental justice ideas, then you've got substantive claims of environmental justice, this idea of equality of distribution of environmental benefits and burdens. You've got procedural justice and administrative decision making. And Rebecca Sozi calls this a citizenship model, where you're combining environmental and civil rights. But none of this achieves Indigenous environmental justice. And that's what these other, these New Zealand examples in particular illustrate, that the Indigenous environmental justice goals in New Zealand are a little bit different from mainstream environmental justice goals, where your first goal is for historical reparations for land and environment that have been taken away, right? And then you want political and decision-making control, right? To either control or share, you know, co-management style and decision-making over land and environment and natural resources. You have cultural goals to respect Indigenous culture in decision-making, and in our case, to respect the ideas such as it, you can have metaphysical status and ancestorship in the environment. And then only last come the individual goals about procedural and substantive normal citizenship style of environmental justice. So, and I know Rebecca Sozi has commented on that. She's not the only one, but she was has done that quite early, to combine that environmental justice can only be achieved with that commitment to Indigenous people, to protecting Indigenous lands, Indigenous people, and she's even called it environmental self-determination to maintain your cultural and political status as the peoples in charge of those traditional lands. And that's very much what New Zealand has been doing with its environmental reparations program. So the New Zealand examples show that when you implement Indigenous justice and uphold Indigenous cosmologies and law, then you can come out with legal personality for nature and environmental justice. So we do go that extra step. And so I think it brings us back to thinking about justice as a concept. Like, it's not just about how we distribute things, right? It's about what we value and the kind of society we regard as just. And if we want to get away from this kind of value, this kind of society, these kind of values, then we definitely need to value the natural world differently. I think rights of nature concepts can certainly help change that. I personally don't like the label, don't like rights, because I think it's more than just rights. But it does help us think about that. I think another sort of, you know, part of the frontier, as you might be illustrated in this picture, is maybe to start seeing plants as persons as well. Maybe that's the next step, both the individual concepts of justice as well as the collective. But in the meantime, if we don't get to plants, we can think about how to use legal personality for nature to help change our justice paradigms. So most people think of it as just adding to human rights, sitting alongside, perhaps extending these human rights protections to the natural world, much as we extended the concept of human rights to add a human right to a healthy environment. But I think it's much bigger than that. Partly we didn't focus on rights in New Zealand. I think because we focus on Indigenous conceptions of justice, we revealed the responsibility side. And I think that we've flipped rights on its head to emphasize responsibility as that invisible goal. We could do that certainly if we let it, as long as we're not stuck in this individual citizenship way of thinking. We just need to make that invisible goal the visible one to better focus our attention on what needs to be done for all types of environmental justice. So, yeah, rights are very useful tools, but I think we need that explicit and visible focus on responsibility. So I'll leave you with this alternative relationship with the earth, ko au te awa, ko te awa ko au. Kia ora tātou, and I look forward to the questions and discussion. Where's my end of recording tool? I'm going to find it somewhere.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Catherine. That was wonderful, and especially picking up the subtitle of this panel, Reframing Concepts of Justice, especially with responsibility in mind and guardianship. If you two have any questions for each other, this is a chance to do that. But if not, we can also save the questions for after. Our respondents, Willie and Christian, are waiting to give their responses. And for those of you listening, it looks like a wonderful audience out there, please put your questions into the Q&A, as you've been doing, not into the chat. And before we hear if there's any questions back and forth between David and Catherine, I just wanted to say John Grimm is my husband. I'm about to introduce him because he'll introduce the discussants. I'm Mary Evelyn Tucker. We do a program here on world religions and ecology. John's specialty is indigenous traditions. My specialty is Asian religions, especially East Asia, China, and Japan. This is why we're thrilled to have these extraordinary presentations and now some responses. But if there was one or two questions from Catherine or David, we're happy to hear them. Otherwise, we'll go to responses. Okay, I think we will just go first to responses, and John will introduce our two colleagues. Thank you.
I have the pleasure of introducing the discussants. First, our friend and colleague, Willie Jennings, a professor of systematic theology and Africana studies at Yale Divinity School. Willie has authored the work Christian Imagination, Theology and the Origins of Race, which has also led him to his most recent work, After Whiteness and Education in Belonging. And Willie has been very helpful in leading Yale Divinity School faculty and students in discussions through these issues of race. He's also hard at work now on a book on the doctrine of creation, tentatively titled Reframing the World. Let me also introduce the second discussant, Christian Espinoza Schatz. Christian is a PhD student in the combined doctoral degree program between the School of the Environment and the Department of Anthropology at Yale University. As a second year doctoral student, Christian is working, carrying out a project where he works with Mayan agrarian communities in Guatemala's western highlands. Here he's searching to understand how a historically marginalized group navigates climate change through local environmental knowledge, scientific expertise, and transnational mobility. So, Willie, we look forward to your remarks, and Christian following that, and then we'll generate, hopefully, discussion between the four and before we take the question and answer. So thanks, Willie.
Thanks, Willie.
Thank you, John, for that wonderful introduction. It's always a joy to be in your presence and Mary Evelyn's presence and to be a part of this wonderful conference. I am so glad to be here. I want to thank Drs. Cordero-Heredia and Drs. Iorns for their very informative presentations, both of which underscore the new moment that is upon us, one in which we might intervene in the dominant juridical, geopolitical, scientific, and economic ways of thinking the earth, an intervention with a simple but profound truth. The world is full of persons, some of whom are human. This ancient insight, still often confined inside that label of animist, has been resisted from the very beginning of modern colonialism. Indeed, to see the world as filled with persons directly challenges seeing the world as filled with commodities. We are, in fact, in the midst of an emerging struggle between two fundamentally different visions of existence, one that places the world inside the market and one that places the market inside the world. In my own work, I have been tracing out how these competing visions came to be through the earth-shattering work of three agents: the merchant, the missionary, and the soldier. Together, these three agents reconfigured the earth, turning land and sky, earth and animal, water and people into something they had never been before, isolatable. Together, merchants, missionaries, and soldiers taught us the crucial lessons that flow through the Western psyche, that the world is inanimate and non-communicative, that it is first and foremost a resource for human use, that it may be fragmented, divided up, and marketed among buyers and owners, and that it must be defended, secured, or taken. There were always a few missionaries, merchants, and soldiers who pushed against these lessons, but the power of greed pulled them into a world they could not thwart from emerging. It is the world we all know so well, a world guided by the modern person paradigm, as Dr. Cordero-Heredia noted so nicely. It is the world where nature waits for us to map on it meaning, where the mental model, as Dr. Iron calls it, is one that separates nature from culture, making nature the realm of the extractors, be they scientists or corporations, and making culture the realm of lawyers, scholars, and religionists. But this separation cannot hold if we want to challenge the dominant vision of existence in the Western world. That vision, formed through the interaction of religion with commerce and with the struggle between nations and individuals over land, resources, and sovereignty. The only way forward is for us to return to the ground and that ancient insight of a living world beyond its biology, to its personhood, its connectedness, and its communicative density. That is, to a world that speaks and holds us together. While granting particular non-human persons legal status is a marvelous first step, we cannot imagine that this is anything more than a first step, and one that can easily lead back into the interests and concerns of the market. The question I want to pose for our conversation is one that pushes us to the next step. How might we draw the legal and the juridical understandings of person through to a sensible understanding? And by sensible, I am returning to the original meaning of the word, one that acknowledges the realities acting upon us, that we come to know and understand through all our senses. Moving to a sensible understanding of a world filled with persons will require bringing together again merchants, missionaries, and soldiers, and all those who emerge from their work, scientists and scholars, lawyers and politicians, and so many others who resisted their work, and placing all of us in the midst of those many peoples who never forgot the first truth of the world. I hear you speaking. Thank you very much.
Willie, that is such a remarkable statement. I hear you speaking. It says it all, doesn't it?
It's absolutely marvelous. I was just sending you a message to say how much we loved it.
Thank you, dear friends.
So perfect. I think we were going to go straight to Christian. But thank you for that succinct,
yes,
amazing statement. I was taking notes. We were thanking Willie for his remarkable job.
Good.
Hello, everyone. Yes, so I will begin. As mentioned, my name is Christian Espinosa-Schatz. I'm a second year doctoral student in the combined degree in anthropology and environmental studies here at the Yale School of the Environment. And I'm really honored and humbled to follow such a distinguished scholar as Professor Jennings today in talking about some discussion points. And I also first want to thank Professor Cordero-Heredia and Professor Iorns for their wonderful presentations. I'm very grateful for this opportunity to discuss these important points that they have illustrated on how we might think about reframing concepts of justice in relation to the natural world. Today, there are two themes I really want to talk about in the brief time I have, with the hopes that it will lead to a productive further discussion. So the first point I want to discuss is a relationship between scientific and indigenous knowledge of the environment and how this relationship matters to the legal basis for environmental justice. Second, I want to discuss the centrality of indigenous people to both presentations today. So to start, I now discuss the relationship between scientific and indigenous knowledge. As Professor Cordero-Heredia explained, scientific knowledge of the environment can stand in as the voice of nature, lending an empirical basis upon which rights of nature cases can be argued. Cordero-Heredia's argument that we should push environmental law to more closely reflect the scientific laws of nature resonates with something like the planetary boundaries framework for policy action on global environmental challenges, but apply it to specific landscapes rather than the globe. It seems to me that bringing in science promises to provide a strong empirical base to rights of nature cases. However, what I want to ask is, what kinds of scientific knowledge count in legal cases? I think specifically about Cordero-Heredia's example of anthropology, a human science, whose evidence was not sufficient to drive a meaningful legal case from a human rights perspective. Professor Iorns' presentation, by comparison, did not explicitly discuss scientific knowledge. However, this discussion about kinds of environmental knowledge are no less important. Both Professor Cordero-Heredia and Iorns' presentations show examples in which a legal case brought socio-environmental relations to align more closely with the moral ecologies indigenous people were already deeply aware of in relationship to their landscape. Interestingly, the example in New Zealand was an example in which scientific evidence was not necessary to justify legal action. To conclude this first discussion point, I want to draw attention to the political relations that define these kinds of knowledges. In some instances, indigenous knowledge may be counted as sufficient evidence upon which to base legal claims. But sadly, oftentimes science is seen as a more legitimate form of evidence than indigenous environmental knowledge. By no means do I bring up this point to downplay the importance of science. I do, however, wish to ask the panelists, how do they think legal systems should weigh scientific and indigenous environmental knowledges in view of the political context that often sees one as more legitimate than the other? What can be productive rather than unproductive or worse, destructive strategies of relating the various ways in which humans understand the natural world when brought to the law? And now with my remaining time, I want to now turn to my second point to briefly discuss the importance of indigenous people in both Professor Cordero-Heredia's and Professor Iorns' presentations. I want to start by pointing out a well-known critique I'm sure many here are aware of, which is that when we speak of the Anthropocene or anthropocentric legal systems, we must first be very clear on who gets included and excluded from the anthropos. As both presentations describe, indigenous people throughout the world have developed very different systems of relations between society and the environment than the nature-culture dichotomy that underpins much modern Western thought. And by implicitly excluding indigenous people from ideas of shared humanity, from the idea of the anthropos, indigenous conceptions of socio-environmental relations have been excluded. These cultural differences that often map onto post-colonial power hierarchies, as in the examples today, are of critical importance to legal concepts that underpin justice. Both presentations discuss how different conceptions of socio-environmental relations can lead to just or unjust outcomes, especially in the examples of property and ownership. The theme I'm trying to draw out here is that by including indigenous people in the anthropos of a possibly inevitably anthropocentric legal system, indigenous justice actually begins to become environmental justice at the same time. Thus, though the examples in Ecuador and New Zealand differ in the means by which they seek justice, they end up seeking a relatively similar thing by ways of involving indigenous people. What I would like to now briefly question is how central is this category of indigenous in pursuing the sort of environmental justice we are talking about today? Whose conceptions of socio-environmental relations can be tied to cases of human rights injustices? In particular, can we extend this strategy to seek environmental justice with peasants, or with the Black communities of North and Latin America, or with migrants whose ties to land are quite different? Finally, I would like to ask the panelists what, if any, aspects of Western dominant culture can be co-opted to align with indigenous cosmologies in seeking environmental justice. For example, it seems to me that a recent focus across a wide range of Christian theology on the ethic of creation care could be aligned productively with ideas of guardianship described by Professor Iorn, though Professor Jennings could surely speak to this point much more eloquently than myself. In conclusion, the arguments Professor Cordero-Heredia and Iorns have presented to us today are of critical importance to seeking environmental justice through reframing the very epistemic, cultural, and legal foundations upon which we base justice. I've hoped in this time to generate discussion specifically around the epistemic and cultural foundations, and look forward to speaking more about my questions and other questions now. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Christian. That was very helpful. You bring us to indigenous justice through the anthropos imaging. Very helpful, thank you. Now, hopefully, we will have all four speakers and discussions on the screen together so that you might be able to converse with one another. And there were several questions raised by the discussion. So David and Catherine, would you like to go first, David, and respond to Willie and Christian?
Thank you. Okay, so there's a lot to cover. Do you hear me okay?
Yes.
I think okay, we need to turn our microphones off so we don't.
Okay. So, some initial thoughts. I'm amazed about the Catherine, Professor Iorn's presentation about how New Zealand is dealing with the rights of nature, and the experience in Ecuador is quite different because we are not as a society in the point of thinking about what Western society has taken away from indigenous peoples. We still got these ideas of patronizing or conceiving like the rights of human or rights of indigenous peoples as something that is something like concessions to the indigenous population. So in terms of justice, we haven't arrived to a place where we can see or pass and actually recognize that Western society had done wrong with indigenous. And there is an increasing speech from some groups saying that what Western society has bring to indigenous people is civilization, and that there should walk the path to totally adapt to Western society. And this is a very powerful speech right now in different countries in Latin America. So I want to ask Catherine how they get as a society to the point of discussing this historical justice, reparation, or recognition of the rights of indigenous peoples. So that for me is a really, really important issue. And second, when we talk about the difference about common law and civil law, and that even if New Zealand is a common law country, they are taking the path of the statutory recognition of the rights of nature. And here in Ecuador, we are trying to enforce the constitution provision through the courts and not through the legislative branch, is mainly because we have these, I don't know how to say it. It was kind of a miracle because we were in the Constitutional Assembly in 2007 and 2008, and for some of the politicians, they didn't understand what rights of nature means. So they didn't oppose to the idea. It sounds like a good thing to put in the constitution, and some as a very small group in the assembly were pushing these ideas, and we finally achieved to put it in the constitution, and now is the highest law in the land, and we are trying to enforce that through the courts. But it was something that politicians realize the impact or the scope that this can get after they approve it. So now we don't have the political will to move to the statutory path to enforce those rights. So the only hope that nature and indigenous peoples and activists and nature have is go to the courts. So we are trying to do some strategic litigation that is more frequent in common law countries, actually. So I want to ask Catherine how is working in New Zealand.
Yes, thanks for that, David. So I'm more than happy just to give a few brief comments. I think there are some essential elements. And the first one is political mobilization and objections of the Indigenous peoples themselves. Starting in the late 60s, early 70s, this is, you know, the time of peace, love, and human rights. Okay. And the Maori in New Zealand were watching the events in America with, you know, calls for human rights, particularly in relation to race. And we had a Black Power movement here. They were, you know, modelling themselves on that. So not on an indigenous power, but an ethnic, you know, basis. And we had a land march in 1972, you know, and complaining about all the various, you know, nationwide rights that were taken away, calling for reparations. But then the key thing was the an opposition party promised to institute a historical investigatory tribunal if they got into power, and then they got into power, they had to establish it. So in 1975, we established what they called the Waitangi Tribunal, which it was only recommendatory. It could only look into modern breaches, first, not all the historical ones, actually. They started off just with modern day ones. But it took a while for its reports to be coming out. But so you have this agreement to establish an investigatory body about, you know, what actually happened, what were the injustices, on top of peace, love, human rights, you know, from the 60s and 70s. And then in the early 80s, that started getting traction. And we started realizing this historical, you know, we had ignored the legal basis for the founding of New Zealand, a treaty between the settlers. We'd misinterpreted and the law had misapplied it over the years. And in the late 80s, that all came to light in the courts, actually. It was a combination between legislatures putting terms into legislation about we're going to uphold the principles of the treaty. So, and then courts interpreting that really strongly. So we had all of those things come together. I must also note that the Indigenous peoples now is at least 15% of the population. Back then, I can't remember exactly, but we're talking more than 10% of the population. So it's a little different in terms of numbers, strength, but also visibility. All right, and visibility, many more moved to cities in the 60s as a result of other changes. And another factor that goes on in terms of an ethos for the country, we have a stronger, in terms of, you know, if you want to go between like liberty and equality, we've got a much stronger social justice equality focus that was like the founding of the country focused more on equality than it did on the American concept of individual liberty. Right. So we have a much more social, a stronger social welfare network and more concern for those kinds of things. And I'd say despite neoliberalism, we still have that slightly stronger today. Anyway, so you've got all of those social convergences and we've got a much stronger acceptance of Indigenous rights. And now we've got, you know, Indigenous politicians in proportion to their percent of the population, if not more. We've got more than 15% in Parliament as a result. So we've got it just, you know, people accept the need. So I know this is probably a bit long, but people accept the need for justice generally around the country, even within that spectrum of divergent views. It's a groundswell. We have huge numbers of people, non-Māori, I guess not just parents of Māori children, but non-Māori in New Zealand learning to speak Māori, right?
That's marvelous, Catherine. It's as if the land is speaking now to all the population of New Zealand. Willie, can I call for your entry into this discussion?
Absolutely. I want to again thank Catherine and Davey for your wonderful presentations. And listening to your discussion, it just underscores for me the significance of seeing the connection between race and place, seeing the connection between people fighting for their rights and the recognition that their rights are tied inextricably to the rights of the land, as it were, but also to the existence of the land, that you can't separate the existence of land from the existence of people. It also occurs to me listening to you both, and this ties into what Christian was mentioning in his wonderful comments as well, that one of the great challenges is whether, in fact, either legal discourse or scientific discourse is sufficient enough to capture what needs to happen and what has already happened in New Zealand. The more I hear about New Zealand, the more I want to move. I really want to go live in New Zealand. It's like the most wonderful place on the planet.
Before the election day, the largest number of spikes in how do I move to New Zealand searches were done on the internet from the USA than any other time in history. Unfortunately, it's the absolute worst time to move because they won't let you in.
Can I invite
Rightly so.
Will you join the conversation? Don't hesitate to bring one or more of these excellent questions you raised, but your own contribution, please. Christian, are you able to hear me?
Unmuted. Yes, I think these are very important and interesting points. And I actually was looking at one of the more top voted questions about the way in which a violation of rights against Indigenous people because of this tie to the land is when viewed holistically, and I think even empirically through various analytical lenses, is tied, and to count one as different from the other in legal terms is actually to a certain degree kind of an artificial distinction that doesn't actually exist in the socio-environmental relations that occur there. So I think that's quite interesting to think through in terms of some of the things that Professor Cordero-Heredia said in terms of the way that we should strive for environmental law to relate to the laws of nature. It seems to me that maybe there are some promising things we can look to in New Zealand in which there's not these sort of artificial distinctions taking place. But I was also reflecting on the specific challenges in Latin America to creating this framework. I know from the work I've been doing in Guatemala since I've started this PhD is that the discourse is very far away from recognizing the need for reparative justice towards indigenous people. And even though over almost half of the population speaks a Mayan language, still there's a very deeply felt racism, and it's much closer to what Professor Cordero-Heredia mentioned of this sort of ideal of civilizing indigenous people rather than accepting their knowledge as legitimate, which I think tied to my questions of how to bring in science, which has some very important things to say about when harms against nature or harms against society occurs, but then how to bring on a level playing field the knowledge that indigenous people themselves have formed over many, many years through attachment to place.
Good.
Yes. So I just wanted to throw that out there. Thanks.
Can I just bring those three together and comment that I think there's like one of the ways we've seen indigenous cosmologies recognized and in law, and you bring the respect and the law in together is through religion. If you actually treat it as a recognized religion and you uphold the equality, the need to recognize it, you can actually achieve a lot of those protections. And as an example, a lot of the places where First Nations rights in America have been denied, where they could have been upheld, even within the law, is through the recognition of their religion. And so, for example, to not desecrate sacred sites. I think it was putting wastewater on a mountain for ski, things in Arizona, as an example, for artificial snow. There's all sorts of places not desecrating actual, mining, taking tops off mountains, or there's all sorts of aspects where it can come in. But if you treat that as a recognized religion, you join these two, and that also gets at David's point about if you treat it as not worthy of respect, then of course you're not going to, you don't put it. So putting it in that different category as a religion to be another worldview that needs to be respected and accommodated as much as possible, then you actually achieve a lot of those different goals all at once. And it's just that one little tool.
Yeah. David, perhaps you have a comment too. And I just wanted to remark that the approach of religion, I would agree, Catherine, is very helpful, though the term religion also has its segregating character and it has stereotypes. So I find the term lifeway at least reintroduces the integral character of these wisdom traditions that we're talking about. Yes, springboard of religion. David.
Thank you. Okay, there's a lot of discuss. Actually, I think we are discussing again something that as mankind, we discussed it like 3 or 4 centuries ago. But what I meant is that in some point of the philosophy, we ask themselves as a humanity, what happened if we move or put aside from religion in terms of recognizing human dignity? There are some ways to recognize that people have a value, putting aside its origin from gods or from divinity. And I think this is very important because if we combine the science and religion aspect of these discussions, we can found a place where they can work together. Because at the same time, I think science, and specifically a natural science, and that's one of the positions that I want to do about my presentation. When I talk about laws of nature, I talk about natural science. And natural science can give us a tool to show to all mankind where are we heading to. And that is really important. We should first to recognize that we are going to a place where we don't want to be. We are extinguishing thousands of species right now. We are putting a lot of pressure through climate change to the poorest parts of the world. And even in the global north, the impacts of climate change and environmental degradation are probably in the last decades, that pressure was more in the global south, but now the global north is also seeing the consequences of how we are dealing with nature, how we are treating nature. Mm-hmm. The for some people, even COVID got its origin on how we treat nature, how we cut the boundaries between some animals and people, and how when we just eliminate those boundaries, then some diseases that live in animals come to people. So we right now through science we can see what is going on, or how we are getting to, or in the future. So that is really important thing. And the second thing is that even if we got this connection with nature as indigenous peoples have, and Christian just said about the idea of creation of the Catholic idea of also a connection with God, and that means also a connection with nature, or some other people as me, that we are not indigenous or we are not Christian, but we believe rationally that we got to protect nature. We can all come together to believe or that we got to take action. And probably that connection or that call for action will be stronger in people who really, as a spiritual thing, believes in nature as a living being. Yeah. But I think we all come together in this idea.
Yes.
And science will be fundamental to that.
Yes. We want to get a few of the questions in as well, and back to Willie for before we do that. But David, I wanted to pick up, you know, the United Nations Environment Program now has a Faith for Earth. We've been working for 25 years with the world's religions on this forum on religion and ecology. There's also at UNEP an interfaith rainforest initiative that's developed over the last 5 years, and we're hoping to partner with our School of the Environment. Incredible combination of indigenous traditions and Christian groups and rainforests around the world. Laudato Si, the Pope's encyclical. Yeah. Bill McKibben says it's the most important document of the 21st century. Cry of the Earth, Cry of the Poor. You know, we're really coming together on these issues. But I just wanted to get Willie in before we take some questions, because you know, you're working on doctrine of creation. Yeah. What about doctrine of discovery? Mm-hmm. But yeah. in any way that you want to jump in for a moment before we go back to some questions.
And that's been a crucial part. I appreciate what David has said and the plea he's making for a kind of conciliatory way of thinking about science's involvement and all of us thinking together. But we do want to be aware of what the doctrine of discovery shows us. It shows us the incredible, unrelenting power of greed. Yeah. And having a market that doesn't only thwart this, but a market that cultivates greed. Yeah. And a market that constantly wants to turn all our efforts toward one crucial question: can we make money off of it? And so I think we have to recognize that the coming together can be thwarted and redirected. And so the question for me is, how do we reimagine market as a fundamental goal of getting people to see the world filled with persons, some of which are human. Because until we understand that that very idea challenges the prevailing idea of market, and we have to aim it toward challenging the prevailing idea of market and the prevailing work of turning things into commodity and the prevailing work of resisting any indigenous voices that would challenge the market sensibilities, because that's really what's at stake. I mean, as Christian was saying earlier, I mean, indigenous voices are being resisted because what they're saying, we can't make money off of it. And so how do we challenge that? Because until we recognize that so many nation states are fundamental believers in the market, that's where their faith is. That they're fundamental believers in the market. In fact, they're fundamentalist in believing in the market. And until we challenge that kind of market fundamentalism that drives so many of the desperate acts of nation states that then allows them to unleash violence on indigenous peoples, you know, we're not going to really be able to scratch where it truly itches.
Right. That's super, very powerful, I should say. I want to come to some of the questions that are terrific, and we won't get to all of them, unfortunately, but one is a suggestion I just put forward. The very last question is, do you want to help push the rights of nature in the Convention on Biodiversity, which is now developing a new framework for action? And of course, IUCN, International Union for Conservation of Nature, has a section that's also highlighting this, along with sacred sites that Catherine has mentioned earlier. So I just put that forward. And I'm going to just raise two questions that pick up one of Willie's points, actually, and that's for David, and then one for Catherine. So one for David is, can the rights of nature be used to help violence against indigenous peoples, which, of course, is a huge thing, and the protection of indigenous peoples now is a major effort around the world. And Catherine, one of the questioners was asking, can the rights of nature help with issues of pollution with the river, you know, very specifically? So maybe just briefly, and then we've got some other questions as well. David, over to you.
Okay, thank you. Actually, some of the cases that are I presented in the first part of the presentation were about that. When we have a Western oriented legal system, so for our system, the claims of indigenous peoples of respect for the land are defeated by some other legal provisions, like the right of the state to extract oil or to extract minerals from their territories. So protecting the indigenous people's rights and protecting nature in those cases are the same thing as Christian said earlier. So if we get stronger protection to nature, we can combine that with the protection of indigenous people's rights. When I talk about anthropologists' work, for example, I was talking about the Tagari and Toremenane people, these peoples that are living in voluntary isolation, because we cannot ask them what they think about an oil extraction or drilling practices in their territories. So we should like use these social science approaches to try to understand where are they moving, for example, where are their houses, and try to frame what are the living in all the spaces that we can get. So we can try to protect them. But right now, we cannot present law cases in the name of these peoples because we are not their lawyers. We don't have an authorization.
Yeah.
But at the same time, nature got this provision or the right of representation. Every single person in the country can go to the court and ask for protection of nature. So we are trying to protect nature or indigenous peoples through nature. Yeah.
Great. Very briefly, because we want to have maybe one word at the end from everybody. So Catherine, another question that came up there was, is New Zealand's case and UNDRIP, United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous peoples, are they any are they comparable? So you have very quickly two questions.
Yeah, two questions. Okay. So in terms of the United Nations Declaration, yes. There's a lot of what we do would uphold the declaration. I mean, we're not everything, obviously, in this country. We're not perfect, but there is a in this particular example, this illustration, especially of reparations, is exactly the kind of thing that would best meet UNDRIP in terms of reparations generally. I'm not going to go into details about particular, you know, whether it could be done better or not, right, in some aspect. But I think it's a really interesting question about that pollution. Will giving a river legal personhood and giving it some guardians, will that mean that it's always going to win, you know, on everything about the river? And that, I think, comes back to Willie, you know, if you come back to that bigger picture where you hit the nail on the head saying it depends on your framework. Is it still one of greed, right? Do we still have a slavery system for the laws that we've set up effectively in relation to nature? So what we've got is we've got a procedural setup. We don't actually have a lot of detail. If you want to look at the law, there's not a lot of detail about how it's going to operate. So outside of the statute, the local government has set up made a new appointment of a person whose job it is to liaise solely between the local government and its processes and the new legal guardians. Okay, so there's all these different legislative bodies that make decisions in relation to the river that now the guardians have to interact with. So what you've done is given them a voice, but it's not actually a seat at the decision-making table necessarily yet. So we've set up a procedure more than a substance. So what will it mean? Well, there's great hope that simply by having a voice, being visible, having a separate legislation that means you've got to, they've got to be upholding their interests, there's a hope that they'll insert themselves into these processes. And if they're not working, then they're going to be taking someone to court. Yes, that's the hope.
Okay.
We haven't had long enough for it to be taking people to court on that basis yet. So we don't know what one of the questions is about. But
that's super. One final very, very brief comment, if we can. We'll start with Christian and then Willie and then Catherine and then David. Really brief, though. This has been so wonderful. Christian.
I suppose the brief final comment that I will make is the possibilities of this sort of reframing of justice to think about climate change, an issue that has been briefly mentioned here. But I think this our conversation provides a very holistic way to think about both the proximate but very non-proximate harms of climate change and incorporating indigenous relations to the weather and the land and other relations to the weather and land that aren't based on greed and what the climate can give us and what carbon can give us provides a very promising pathway forward. And I'm curious how that functions in relation to the law, which has been a tricky place for climate change in relation to the law, I believe. So thanks.
Perfect. That's a helpful connection.
Very, very thanks. Good. Thanks. Over to you, Willie.
So my final comment is, again, to thank our presenters and to thank Dave and Christian for his wonderful comments. But I want to leave us with a question about rights and responsibilities. I wonder if thinking about trash might be a way to deepen this conversation and to deepen the conversation with government agencies and with corporations, that the production of trash is the responsibility of all. And that responsibility means that we have to think much more deeply about how we are damaging not only ourselves, but damaging the earth.
Yeah. Wonderful. Okay, and we're coming back to sensibility at another time, your other comment. Thank you so much, Willie. Catherine. You had such a great presentation. One final comment.
So I've already made that difference in the comment between rights and responsibilities. So now I want to think of, and we've got our focus on Indigenous justice in New Zealand. So think of it from an Indigenous perspective. This is just maybe a lesson for people to think about their own practice. Do you really want to call our examples rights of nature? examples? Are they really rights of nature examples? When you use that label, are you therefore completely denying the role of the Indigenous perspective and the Indigenous work? And is that just another form of colonization? So just by using that label in respect of our examples.
How about, Catherine, how about Earth jurisprudence? Does that have the same connotation?
No. This was Indigenous rights. These were an Indigenous reparations program. It's an Indigenous rights recognition of Indigenous cosmology. And so you can answer lots of questions, like about Christian Science, you know, by saying, yes, you can bring in Indigenous and Western science through respect if you choose to. So choosing to acknowledge the role of Indigenous peoples in that justice struggle.
Excellent. Thank you. And David, you have the last word. Thank you.
Actually, when we see the process of Ecuador getting the rights of nature and the constitution, you can see from the social movement's perspective that indigenous people get a lot of say in that process. And actually, we call the Pachamama, that means Mother Earth. We put it in the constitution. So we said that the Pachamama or nature got these rights. So what I was saying in my presentation is that actually talking about nature's rights is not to put something Western in indigenous people's world, but to try to understand what a relationship that has been always in the indigenous people's world, and we as Western people are trying to understand that relation and trying to learn from that relation, and I see a lot of hope that we can do that, because it's not the first time where the humanity got to deal with these kind of issues of doing a very lap in terms of changing their mentality. We have a lot of now we get a lot of goods that are outside the market. We put people outside the markets in some point of humanity, and now is something that we cannot conceive that people can be treated as a good. So we can do those kind of changes in humanity. We got to work a lot on that, but that is really, really important. Mm-hmm. If we are a poor family, we cannot think to sell one of our kids to sustain the rest of those. So why we don't do that? Because we think that human life is worth a value. If we believe that nature got that value, then we can move forward and think on another ways to live.
Fantastic.
Wonderful. With deep appreciation to all of you for your remarks.
So we really want to thank you all, Christian, Willie, Catherine, David. Thank you.
Yes.
And thanks to all Amity and Gerald for organizing this remarkable conference. We're going to draw on all of this in our classes here at Yale.
And Gerald and Amity would have so much to
say
here.
Thank you. And Kristen and Grace, thanks so much. Thanks, Amity.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. I want to thank everyone who came to the conference, and I want to thank all of our participants. I feel enriched It's a great joy for me to put on a conference, because I basically was reaping off. So thank you, everyone. I'm glad this is going to be recorded. So it is recorded. So it'll be preserved. Before we move on to the next phase, though, what I'd like to do, and then I'll turn it over to Amity, is I'd like to thank the people who you didn't really get to see on camera. But it wouldn't have happened without them. So Christian Berenbeck Ludwig, who was described as the lieutenant, played a really crucial role. Thomas Easley brought us the film, as well as innumerable insights as we constructed the conference. Grace Hilbert is... She was like somebody plugging all the holes in the dikes. You guys didn't see any of that. She did it. It got done. And then we have some student volunteers I'd like to call out and thank. So Helia Badad, Lonnie Chang, Niti Jane, Tina Perez, Lavinia Reynolds, Kieran Rudge, and Krista Shannon. I know most of those students, and I want to thank you sincerely for your work and your help. Amity, I don't know if you wanted to say anything before we move on.
Oh, goodness. Well, I have to agree. It's been an incredibly enriching 2 days. It feels like it's been an odd time warp as we sit in our little cubicles and relate to these topics around the world, from New Zealand to Ecuador to Africa, Liberia, and back. It's a lot to take in, but I always find it really inspirational. It reminds me why I care so much about these things. And the fact that we started talking about negotiations, international negotiations, and the role of values and morality and justice, and then we ended right back there with how do we get to move beyond greed, beyond some of the market-based logics that drive so much of our interactions, and open up the possibilities of reframing what is justice in relationship to people and the natural world, I think is really an amazing route of discovery that we've been on. And I also do just want to end with I do think the, I mean, under this umbrella of environmental justice, we've had such a wide-ranging discussion, but what we can never forget is that it brings us to this emphasis on the fact that any exploitation of natural resources is linked to exploitation of people, and that, you know, we need to figure out how to decouple those linkages and to place both natural rights and human rights back in the center of how we interact with each other and the natural world. And I think I have faith that we're going to get there, but it may not be in any big rush. I think we're going to continue to stumble our way along, but with the great minds like we've had here, I think it's pretty amazing. So those are my last words. And thank you to all the participants and everyone. It's been truly remarkable.